with the family.
Yeah.
You don't.
How does Steve Bannon not know that?
Yeah.
But AB, I'm more interested in what the thinking was behind the Charlottesville stuff, right? So obviously, remember that exploded and became so inflammatory when the president said, well, there are good people on both sides and didn't want to condemn the people, the neo-Nazis and the people who were marching for the KKK. This is a little insight into how he felt about the KKK and why he seemed sympathetic. Privately, the president kept trying to rationalize why someone would be a member of the KKK. That is, they may not actually believe what the KKK believed, and that the KKK probably does not believe what it used to believe. And anyway, who really knows what the KKK believes?
Why else
now
would you join the
Everyone.
KKK? Do they have good benefits?
Everyone.
Is there like an insurance plan or something that goes along with it? Why else would you join?
But this is insightful, I think, AB, that he wanted to be able to say there are good people on both sides. So he's ruminating. But surely they can't be as bad as we've all heard. Maybe there's something in it for everybody.
Go ahead.
Almost, you can pass.
Idea.
I'll be your lifeline
if you
like.
I'm visualizing that the KKK hands out really good swag. Yeah.
You're
so
not really with
the
brand, but the benefits package is just too good, AB.
Right. So, look, I mean, we remember this famous moment with Jake Tapper when Donald Trump, then candidate, didn't remember who David Duke was or what white supremacists, you know, want and the KKK. He does this all the time on these topics. He tries to take both sides. He tries to ask questions about what it really means and tries to muddy the waters. The interesting thing about this anecdote in the Wolf book, of course, is that we all remember Chief of Staff General Kelly's face in that just unbelievable sort of spontaneous eruption at a press conference in the elevator hall when Gary Cohn, who is Jewish, and Steven Mnuchin, who is Jewish, stood beside the president as he was talking in this really excited and angry way about Charlottesville. The people who everyone was counting on before the election to sort of prevail upon the president, like his daughter Ivanka and his son-in-law Jared, to sort of calm him down and moderate him, don't have any power. And that this anecdote reveals that they wanted him to come after Charlottesville out with a full-throated response, rejecting all hate groups and white supremacists and everyone else in a formal and forceful way. And instead, he got on the phone with Steve Bannon, and Steve Bannon very much urged him at the time, and this is already been reported months ago, to sort of hang in with the people who were good on the wrong side of this.
Which itself accepts the conflation between the alt-right and the KKK and the neo-Nazi groups. And the fact that any president, what the president was being lobbied to do was to act presidential. It's an office of moral leadership, and this is not a tough call. And this background rumination, well, some of them, I assume, are nice people. Actually, I'm sorry, that was his announcement reference to the Mexican-American community.
That was public. Oh.
But that reaching for equivalence, the reaching for rationalization is deeply outside our best standards as a nation and as a president. It's absolutely insane that the president is apparently ruminating this way in private about trying to find a silver lining.
And you don't need any of the excerpts of the book to make the case of this level of dysfunction. You only need to know what the president has said himself. He said, I never gave this guy access. Mm-hmm. I never talked to him about it. Well, then how did he get in that White House? How did he get so much access? That would never happen in another administration if the person at the top didn't want it. Steve Bannon, he says, look what happens to sloppy Steve now. This guy lost his mind. Well, then why was he so close? If the family matters so much. And again, you know, AB, I grew up in this business, okay? Yeah. If you went against someone named Cuomo around my father, you had a big problem on your hands. You better be right, unless his name was Andrew Cuomo, and then Andrew had his own place where he had to kind of fight his own battles. But so for Bannon to have existed as long as he did, as controversial as he is, as tied to the alt-right as he has said he wants to be with Breitbart, it tells you everything you need to know. You don't need to know the book. Trump does what's good for Trump, and he plays it as long as he can that way.
Trump and Bannon, it really had a strong connection because Trump really saw him as a Goldman Sachs alumni who was a naval officer and had been educated at Harvard, all things that really matter to President Trump, and at the same time was had made a lot of money and wasn't. these scrubs around him, these political hacks, you know, who are desperate for the next government paycheck. And so he was at a different level. But Bannon played this so shrewdly. He basically was this Trump whisperer who convinced the president that he and he alone understood that the president was a leader of an historic movement and that he was not only changing the country, but perhaps the world. And that was something that Jared and Ivanka and Gary Cohn and others were not telling the president. And so he was always saying, look at these people around you. They just don't understand the forgotten man and woman. I do. I understand what your message to them and how much it resonated. And this is why you're such a great leader. And President Trump loves that kind of thing. It's exactly why Bannon hung around so long.
Mm. Of course. And now totally kicked to the curb, dismissed as sloppy Steve, who I thought was the bass player for the Doobie Brothers. But also the incredibly unkind way. I mean, the Mercers, his Bannon's benefactors for years, kicking him to the curb after.